हेलो
हेलो यार,
यार राघव, आई स्टार्टेड द स्ट्रीमिंग बट इट्स नॉट वर्किंग. इट्स नॉट
क्या है विथ
वर्किंग
वर्किंग या योर ऑलरेडी लाइफ मैप?
बट द स्टूडेंट्स आर टेलिंग मी दैट दे कैन नॉट सी. आई एम ऑलरेडी लाइव, आई कैन सी दैट. आई मीन बट इट्स नॉट इवन वर्किंग ऑन माई फोन. आई चेक्ड एंड द स्टूडेंट्स आर सेइंग दैट दे कैन
नो
नॉट
मैम,
सी.
ऑन माय लैपटॉप इट्स वर्किंग मैम. देयर वाज एन यूट्यूब ग्लिच. तो मैम आई आई गेस इट्स फाइन. कैन यू चेक ऑन योर फोन?
कैन आई स्टॉप? सो लेट मी जस्ट चेक इफ दिस इज वर्किंग अगेन एंड देन आई विल बी गुड टू गो. ऑल राइट, सो आई थिंक वी आर गुड टू गो नाउ. येस, सो हेलो फ्रेंड्स,
ऑल राइट,
वेलकम टू अन अकेडमी. लेट्स क्रैक डीट पीजी.
आई
आई एम
थिंक
सॉरी
वी
फॉर
आर
दिस
गुड टू गो
डिस्टर्बेंस.
मैम.
देर सम ग्लिच इन द यूट्यूब थिंग एंड आई थिंक नाउ आई एम लाइव अगेन. आई एम फाइनली, येस, ऑल राइट. ओके, सो गाइज, आई जस्ट क्विकली गिव यू अ ब्रीफ अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ वॉट इज द टॉपिक एट हैंड टू बी डिस्कस टूडे. आई एम गोइंग टू टेक माई डिस्कशन फॉरवर्ड ऑन एंटीनेटल केयर एंड टूडे आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट एंटीनेटल एडवाइसेस. एंड आई जस्ट नीड टू हियर यू नो गिव यू माई रेफरेंस कोड हियर, दैट इज SHONALI. सो इफ यू टेक अ प्लस सब्सक्रिप्शन, यू कैन यूज दिस कोड टू अवेल अ 10% डिस्काउंट. अन अकेडमी प्लस सब्सक्रिप्शन इज इम्पॉर्टेंट एंड इट्स गुड. वाई? बिकॉज द प्लस सब्सक्रिप्शन विल गिव यू अनलिमिटेड एक्सेस टू लाइव एंड रिकॉर्डेड कोर्सेज फ्रॉम इंडियाज बेस्ट एजुकेटर्स. यू विल गेट डेली लाइव क्लासेस. द कोर्सेज आर स्ट्रक्चर्ड कीपिंग इन माइंड द लेटेस्ट नीट पीजी सेलेबस. देर आर लाइव टेस्ट एंड क्विजेस. And most importantly, it's an unlimited access to all of the live sessions from all of the faculties who are active on the platform. And even if you miss out on the live sessions, you can always go back and watch the recorded versions from the comfort of your own devices. Top educators are associated with the platform, and all 19 subjects which we need to prepare are covered on the platform. And every now and then, you know, comprehensive batch courses and short duration crash courses that keep getting launched. So you can check out the ongoing courses on the platform as well. And as far as the subscription packages go, you can take one depending upon your need and requirement. So if you're looking for a crash course for the upcoming exams, you can take the 3 months or 6 months course. For those of you who are targeting the next year mid-year exams, you can take the 12-month subscription. It will give you enough time to go through all the sessions, revise also in the end. Turns out to be more economical also in the longer run. And for those of you who want a much slower pace of preparation, you're in your third year or final year MBBS, you can take the 24-month subscription. It turns out to be far more economical in the longer run as well. And if you subscribe using my code, that is SHONALI, then you can avail a 10% discount also on whatever subscription package that you choose from. All right. So good evening, Rashmi, Osborne, Srigiri, Saurabh, Janani, and Dr. Musarrati was the first one to join in. So welcome everybody. Let us not waste any further of your time and start talking about the aspects of essential antenatal care. Essential, why? Because they are the right of a pregnant woman. They are deserved by any pregnant woman, irrespective of where she lives or what she does for a living, right? So irrespective of her socio-economic and cultural aspects or status, every woman deserves an essential antenatal care. Right? So what I'm going to talk about, the regular ANC checkups, I've told you yesterday how important they are to help us identify the high-risk pregnancies, to help us, you know, identify the complications earlier. And we want to put in preventive care in place, isn't it? We want to give her iron folic acid supplementation. We want to give her immunization. So all these aspects are the aspects of essential antenatal care. Eventually, it goes without saying that ultimately the healthy outcome of a pregnancy will come if there is a healthy mother, isn't it? So a healthy mother will give rise to a healthy baby, and then her pregnancy will be, you know, without any complications. So maintain and promote the health status of the woman is very, very important. And we need to educate the mother about the normal physiological changes of pregnancy. Because you see, many times women, they are undergoing a lot of change during pregnancy, during those 9 months. And it's a period of adjustment also. So she could be bothered by certain ailments, certain symptoms which she is worried about. So we need to educate the mother that these are nothing but certain physiological changes of pregnancy, which will be tided over, which will be, over once the pregnancy is over. So we need to educate the mother about that. We need to educate the mother about, importance of perception of fetal movements. We need to educate her about the symptoms or the danger signs, when she should immediately report to the emergency department. So those are the aspects of essential antenatal care. And yes, of course, I told you already that we have to address her concerns at every step and deal with the minor ailments accordingly. Maybe sometimes just counseling will help, or maybe sometimes, medication might be required. So my focus today is going to be on folic acid administration in first trimester. I'm going to talk about that. Ebionization, advice on diet, iron and folic acid prophylaxis, advice on when to report, and these some of the minor ailments we will talk about that as well, and how to manage them. Okay, and you will understand that part of the management is all about counseling the woman adequately. So let's talk about folic acid supplementation in first trimester. Now, there is a very specific reason why this is being given, and specifically in the first trimester. So why is this folic acid supplementation required? Yes, why is this folic acid supplementation required or promoted in the first trimester? This is given for the prevention of neural tube defects. Now, neural tube defects are, congenital anomalies which a fetus can have, and they are multifactorial. There are many reasons by which neural tube defects arise. But one thing that has been certainly seen is that folic acid supplementation in the periconceptional period, that means around the time of conception, if given, it prevents neural tube defects in pregnant mother. I mean, it prevents the neural tube defects in fetus. Now, what are these neural tube defects? There are various types of neural tube defects, like, of course, you know that anencephaly is one serious type of neural tube defects, where the brain and the skull and the calvaria, that is not developing. There can be spina bifida, there can be encephalocele, or there can be a meningocele and a meningomyelocele. So these group of defects together, where the neural tube during the development of the fetus fails to close, these defects are called as the neural tube defects. It is for the prevention of these neural tube defects that folic acid is recommended in the first trimester. Ideally, it is to be given in the periconceptional period itself. So that is why women who are even trying to conceive, they are advised to take folic acid supplementation. So it should be given from at least 1 month prior to conception, and then it should be continued throughout the first trimester. So what is this periconceptional period that I'm talking about? At least 1 month prior to conception, and then it should be continued throughout the first trimester, so throughout the first 3 months of pregnancy. And what is the recommended dose? Yes, what is the daily recommended dose? The daily recommended dose is 400 microgram per day. Okay, so that is the recommended dose. But there is a slight change here. The slight change is, supposing there is a woman who says that she has had a history of a fetus being affected with neural tube defects. So she can give the history that in my past pregnancy, I had a fetus which us jiska sar nahi bana tha. Okay, the woman might give that kind of a history, ki I had a fetus jiska sar nahi bana tha, and that baby did not survive, right? So she could give history suggestive of a neural tube defect in her prior pregnancy. So very, very important to note here that if there is a history of prior affected fetus, these are important percentages which are asked in your NEET PG examination. So if there is a prior affected fetus, okay, then the risk of recurrence is very high. What is the risk of recurrence? The risk of recurrence in subsequent pregnancy is about 5% when there is one prior affected fetus, And this risk of recurrence increases to about 10% if there are two prior affected fetuses. Okay, so the risk of recurrence is high when there is a history of prior affected fetus. It's 5% where there is one prior affected fetus and 10% when there are two prior affected fetuses. So it is recommended that if there is a history of prior affected child or pregnancy with neural tube defects, then the dose of prophylaxis should be increased to 4 milligram per day instead of the routine 400 microgram per day. So 400 microgram is the routine dose which is given to all pregnant women in the periconceptional period for the prevention of neural tube defects in the fetus. But if there is a history of prior affected child with neural tube defect, then the dose or daily dose of prophylaxis is 4 milligram per day. And it has been seen that giving this dose, giving this increased dose, decreases the risk of recurrence. This decreases the risk of recurrence in subsequent pregnancy by about 70%. By about 70%, the risk is decreased. Risk of recurrence is decreased by about 70% if this increased dosage is taken. Okay. Now, moving on further, let's talk about tetanus immunization. Now, tetanus immunization is also routine in pregnancy in the antenatal period. Now, why is this tetanus immunization important? Tetanus immunization is important, of course, both for the mother as well as for the baby, more so for the baby. It prevents neonatal tetanus, right? So tetanus immunization to the mother is very, very important, right? And when is it given? What is the dose that is given? So the dose is the same like any usual tetanus immunization anytime, even outside pregnancy. So the dose is 0.5 ml. The route is intramuscular and it is given on the upper arm. Right now, the important thing to note is when is it given in pregnancy? What is the recommendation? So the recommendation is that it should be given early in pregnancy. The first dose, the TD1, the first dose should be given early in pregnancy in the first visit itself. So in the first visit itself, the first dose of tetanus immunization should be given. Then TD2, the second dose is given 4 weeks after the first dose. Okay, so there should be at least a gap of 4 weeks. It should not be given before 4 weeks. Okay, so the second dose is given 4 weeks after the first dose of the immunization. And then there is a TDB. B stands for booster. Here B stands for booster. So this booster is given if the pregnancy is occurring within 3 years of the last pregnancy and if in the last pregnancy 2 doses were already received. Okay, so for a woman, let's say for example, a woman says that she had her pregnancy 2 years ago. 2 years ago in her last pregnancy, she had received 2 doses of tetanus immunization. So now in this pregnancy, she'll just receive a booster and that booster is given in the third trimester. Okay, so booster is given when the prior pregnancy has occurred within 3 years and in the prior pregnancy, she had received the complete tetanus immunization. That means 2 doses were given. Now, if she says that her last pregnancy was 5 years ago, if she says her last pregnancy was 5 years ago and in that she had received full tetanus immunization, so now in this pregnancy she will again receive the 2 doses. Okay, so the booster is recommended only if the last pregnancy was within 3 years. Okay, now the other important change that you can see here is, why am I writing TD? What is this TD? Anybody can tell me what is this TD? I'm not writing TT. When I say TT, this is tetanus toxoid, isn't it? When I say TT, this is tetanus toxoid. Can anybody tell me what this TD stands for? What is this TD stands for? Can anybody tell me? This is a recent recommendation by the WHO, which has been adopted also by the government of India. Okay, so what is this TD here? T stands for the tetanus toxoid. In this TD, T stands for the tetanus toxoid and D stands for the diphtheria toxoid. Diphtheria toxoid. And it is in a small d represents a lower dose. Small d represents a lower dose as compared to the dose that is given in children or in younger children during immunization. So that's the difference. This is for the adult diphtheria toxoid. Adult diphtheria toxoid, which is in lower dosages as compared to the to the immunization that is given in the younger children. So basically, now the WHO is recommending, and also adopted by the government of India, that instead of just plain TT, TT should be replaced by TD immunization. All right, TD, tetanus plus an adult diphtheria toxoid, also should be included. So very good, Dipankan. Tdap. Tdap is also recommended. So people are also giving purchases in lower dosages, but so far the government of India has adopted TD. Okay. All right. So that's a new change there. Okay. But please do not say that agar TD nahi hoega, toh hum TT bhi nahi denge. Aisa nahi hai. So if this is not available, please don't say that it is not available, so let's not give. If this is not available, then give plain TT. Okay. Give TT, tetanus toxoid at least. Okay. Now, moving on further, dietary advice. Now, the dietary advice, you know, in pregnancy, the dietary requirement increases. The dietary requirement increases. Why? Because there is increased requirement for the fetus also. There is also increased requirement by the mother also, because the synthesis of proteins and the synthesis of lipids and the fat deposition and protein deposition, all that has to take place in pregnancy. Weight gain occurs in pregnancy. And for that reason, the dietary requirement also increases. But please mind you, do not ever tell the woman to eat for two people. That would just make her obese. Okay, she needs to have a balanced diet. Okay, she needs to have a healthy, balanced diet. On an average, whatever she used to eat before pregnancy, uska 1/4 more quantity should be added to her diet in general. Okay. So that much should be sufficient. So a healthy, balanced diet is required. An extra 350 kilocalorie per day is the requirement of the calorie requirement during pregnancy. So extra 350 kilocalorie per day. And most of this extra calorie requirements is in the second half of the pregnancy, not in the first trimester. So in the first trimester, you know, women are often bothered with nausea, vomiting, and that altered taste, and she's not able to eat. She is very worried ki mere se to khaya hi nahi ja raha. So you know that at that point in time, you just have to reassure her that, you know, it's not dangerous. So don't worry, your dietary requirements are more concentrated in the second half of pregnancy. Let this nausea and vomiting settle down, and then you would be able to eat again. So extra calorie requirement is more so in the second half of pregnancy. Protein requirement is also increased. So in a normal average built woman, the protein requirement is somewhere around 1 g/kg per day. So if a woman is weighing 50 kgs or 60 kgs, then correspondingly the protein requirement is 50 to 60 grams per day. So the protein requirement is also increased to about 1.2 to 1.5 gram per kg per day. Now this is quite a lot. Okay, so people also say that, you know, drinking milk every day is very good. Drinking a liter of milk, you know, this protein requirement, mind you, is going to be fulfilled by drinking a liter of milk every day. So yes, she can be asked to, you know, eat protein rich food. If she's not drinking a liter of milk every day, she can be asked to take egg whites. She can be asked to, if she's a non-vegetarian, she can eat her non-vegetarian sources of protein as well. So altogether, a dietary advice should focus on maintaining a healthy, balanced diet, which takes care of the extra calories intake, it takes care of the extra protein intake, and also additionally carbs will definitely be required also. The daily calcium requirement in pregnancy is also doubled. So somewhere about, you know, 500 milligrams per day calcium requirement, it has to be increased to about 1000 milligrams per day, 1000 milligrams per day. So that's that's a doubling of calcium requirement. And please also understand that such a doubled amount of calcium requirement is usually not met by diet alone, and that's why calcium supplementation in pregnancy is also required. Because if you consider the Indian diet, the grain rich diet, the type of diet that we take is inherently thoda sa, on the calcium deficient side. So that has also to be taken into consideration while giving dietary advice to the woman. You do have to focus on the socio-economic factors, hai na? Abhi kisi gareeb insaan ko nahi bol sakte ki roz chicken mutton khao. Just an example that the dietary advice should focus on the cultural practices of the woman also, what she eats, and around that her dietary advice should revolve. Now the next important aspect is that the requirement of iron and folic acid also increases in pregnancy, isn't it? So the iron is required to build up the hemoglobin RBC mass of the mother. The fetus is also forming its own blood mass and own hemoglobin and everything. So for that, iron is required. Folic acid is also required for the same purpose. So these iron and folic acid requirements also increases, and they ask you a direct one-liner question in the exam. These are important one-liner points. All of these points that I've highlighted are important points to note as far as NEET PG is concerned. So daily requirement of folic acid increases to about 500 microgram per day. In a non-pregnant state, it is somewhere around 200 microgram per day, and it increases to 500 microgram per day. And if you talk about the iron requirement daily, then it is about 6 to 7 milligrams per day of iron. And this is the iron, mind you, that needs to be absorbed. And you should also be aware of the fact that whatever iron which is present in our diet, we don't absorb the entire iron, do we? No, the iron absorption is probably even in the best sources. If you consider the non-vegetarian sources of iron, then from the diet we are able to extract only 30% of the iron that is contained in the diet. So again, my emphasis on the point is that the increased requirement of folic acid and iron and calcium, they are increased to an extent that they cannot be met by diet alone, right? So 6 to 7 milligram is the amount of iron that needs to be absorbed. Dr. Musarrat, what is the total amount of iron that is required in pregnancy? Well, the total amount of iron that is required in pregnancy is about 1000 milligrams, okay? So that is the total amount of iron which is required in pregnancy. So moving forward, let's talk about now iron and folic acid supplementation. So this iron folic acid supplementation is a routine for every pregnant woman, all right? And the government of India has laid down guidelines as to when it should be given and how much it should be given. So in pregnant women, the daily iron and folic acid, there's a single tablet, okay? And this single tablet is started from the 4th month of pregnancy, that is after 16 weeks. It is started from the 4th month of pregnancy, that is after 16 weeks, that is from the second trimester. And this one tablet contains 60 milligrams of elemental iron and 500 micrograms of folic acid. It's red in color, it's sugar coated, right? So the government of India, in the latest guidelines, which is according to the Anemia Mukt Bharat, along the guidelines which are given by the Anemia Mukt Bharat scheme, and also the guidelines from WHO, both WHO also, they recommend 60 milligrams of elemental iron plus 500 micrograms of folic acid. So yes, we have been reading about 100 milligrams of elemental iron along according to the RCH scheme, Reproductive and Child Health Care Scheme. But last year, this Anemia Mukt Bharat scheme was launched, and the WHO also recommends the same thing, that is each tablet should contain 60 milligrams of elemental iron. Elemental iron, Mariam, means that there can be various tablets, there can be various forms of iron, like it could be iron sulfate, it could be ferrous sulfate, it could be ferrous ascorbate or glycinate or any other iron form, right? So in all of these iron forms, the content of the elemental iron should be 60 milligrams. So it is just to homogenize that no matter what the salt is, the elemental iron content should be 60 milligrams. That is what it means, okay? And it should be given for a minimum of 180 days. So 180 days is about 6 months, isn't it? 180 days is about 6 months. So that means that if somebody starts it in the second trimester, after the second trimester, she technically takes it throughout her pregnancy, isn't it? And then it's not, that's not all. The important thing to note here is that even with lactating mothers after delivery also, the same iron folic acid supplementation should again continue for a period of 180 days, again for another 6 months in total. In the postpartum period, when she's breastfeeding, lactating, she's supposed to take the same tablet daily again. Okay, so this is about iron and folic acid supplementation. Now, can anybody tell me why are we not giving this iron and folic acid supplementation in the first trimester? Why not in first trimester? Yes, why are we not giving this iron and folic acid supplementation? I mean, the folic acid that we are giving in the first trimester is 400 microgram. That is for prevention of neural tube defects. That's different. But why are we not giving any iron tablets in the first trimester? Yes, anybody? Janani, hyperemesis. Yes, one of the reasons why we are not giving iron in the first trimester, very good, is GI upset, very good. That is the reason, because in the first trimester, the woman is already troubled with nausea, vomiting, you know, altered taste of mouth and everything. So if she's going to take iron tablets, her nausea and vomiting can worsen. Iron tablets, they also lead to GI side effects. So she will not be able to tolerate iron if iron tablets are given in the first trimester. She will not be able to tolerate them only. She will not be able to take them only. And moreover, the majority of the iron requirement, again, that 6 to 7 milligram per day of iron that needs to be absorbed, from the diet, all that requirement is mainly concentrated in the second half of pregnancy. And that's why iron supplementation is required in the second half of pregnancy, right? Now, another doubt here is from Debankan, that I told 400 micrograms in first trimester. That 400 microgram Debankan, that is the recommended dose in the first trimester, is for the prevention of neural tube defects. Okay, ideally it should be begun in the periconceptional period, at least 1 month prior to conceiving. All right, or 1 month prior to getting pregnant. And once a woman is on that folic acid supplementation, she continues that for the first 3 months of pregnancy. That's why the dose is different, okay? Here, when we talk about iron and folic acid supplementation in the second half of pregnancy, that is for prevention of maternal anemia. This iron folic acid supplementation is for prevention of anemia in pregnancy, okay? And the recommended dietary allowance, the recommended daily allowance of folic acid in pregnancy is increased to 500 microgram of folic acid. You see, both iron and folic acid are required for prevention of anemia, isn't it? Iron is required for the hemoglobinization of the RBCs. Folic acid is required for the nucleus development, the DNA development, all that requirement for the RBC synthesis. So both are required for prevention of anemia in pregnancy. Okay. Yes, Debankan, it's the HCG effect which causes nausea and vomiting in pregnancy. All right. So that's about iron and folic acid supplementation. Clear on this? Any other doubt? Mariam, you're rightly saying that physiological anemia is also more likely to happen in the second trimester itself. That is why all of these reasons are the reasons why focus on iron and folic acid supplementation in the second trimester onwards and not prefer to be given in the first trimester. Okay. Now, moving on further, what are the general antenatal advices which we give to the pregnant woman? So, rest and sleep is again very, very important. Okay, so a pregnant woman is expected to sleep about 8 hours in the night, and she should at least take 2 hours of rest in the daytime, in the afternoon. So, she should get adequate rest and sleep. It is, has to be emphasized. Bowel habits. Now, what about bowel habits? So, usually in pregnancy, the bowel habits are altered. Why so? Can anybody tell me what happens to the bowel habits in pregnancy? How are the woman's bowel habits affected in pregnancy? Normally in pregnancy, there's a lot of progesterone, isn't it? There's a lot of progesterone which is coming from the placenta, isn't it? So in pregnancy, placenta is synthesizing increasing amounts of progesterone. Now, this progesterone causes smooth muscle relaxation. Now, the gut is also smooth muscle, isn't it? So smooth muscle relaxation in the gut will lead to constipation, will lead to constipation. So woman is often bothered with constipation in pregnancy. All right. Moreover, as pregnancy is going to advance, the gravid uterus, right, the uterus can, press on the rectum and colon, and that is why it can also, increase the constipation in pregnancy. So bowel habits are altered. Now, how does a woman get over that? You need to counsel the woman that if she's going to have a good fiber-rich diet, if she's going to drink plenty of water, then her bowel habits are going to improve. So that is what you have to counsel her about, right? Maintaining adequate hydration is again very, very important in pregnancy. Oral hygiene. So oral hygiene is also important, because you see, there should not be any, so in general hygiene is important, because any infection, any source of infection should be avoided in pregnancy. Advice on smoking and alcohol in general is given, that smoking should be stopped, alcohol should be stopped. Taking alcohol in the first trimester can lead to congenital malformations in the baby. So if she's a woman is taking alcohol or consuming alcohol in the first trimester, in the periconceptional period, during the time of embryogenesis, which is somewhere between 2 to 9 weeks. So during that time, alcohol can cause a syndrome which is called as the fetal alcohol syndrome. Fetal alcohol syndrome, right? So we can have teratogenesis and fetal malformations if the mother is consuming alcohol. Smoking, on the other hand, predisposes to intrauterine growth retardation. Smoking predisposes to intrauterine growth retardation. So these are the reasons why smoking and alcohol should definitely not be continued during pregnancy and needs to be emphasized upon. Any history of fever needs to be asked about, because fever by itself can harm a pregnancy. High grade fever can harm a pregnancy. It can cause intrauterine fetal death. And if there is a fever, there could be an infective cause of fever also, so that needs to be looked into. So any history of fever should be inquired about. Women also seek advice on intercourse and coitus. So there is no recommendation as to the fact that coitus should be stopped in pregnancy or anything. So there is no limitation to that one cannot have intercourse during pregnancy. But yes, if a woman is it will also depend upon what are the social and cultural aspects of the woman and her partner. No, but even then, medically, there is no restriction on intercourse in pregnancy. But yes, if a woman has a history of bleeding during pregnancy, if a woman has a history of a low-lying placenta or a placenta previa in pregnancy, these are situations where I would specifically ask the woman to avoid intercourse, right? So this is the general advice, general antenatal advice, which is given to all women. Now, what is the advice on when to report in pregnancy? So when should she report to pregnancy? If she has any high grade fever, if she has any painful uterine contractions, if there's any vaginal bleeding, if she complains of decreased fetal movements, or if she has any leaking of fluid from the vagina, these are the points pointers. These are the danger signs which are advised to the woman. And then if any of these happen, she should be asked to report in the emergency, right? So I'm particularly emphasizing on high-grade fever. I'm particularly emphasizing on high-grade fever because women during pregnancy, and especially it's a very early change in pregnancy, they often complain that they are feeling feverish. They will say that hararat si lagti hai. It feels as if my palms are too warm. Aisa lagta hai ki sar se garmi nikal rahi hai. You know, there's a tendency to just feel warm. But if you measure the temperature will say 99 degree Fahrenheit. It will not cross 100.4. okay, so fever which crosses 100.4 degree Fahrenheit is significant, but a sense of feverishness, women generally tend to complain of that in pregnancy. They feel ke mujhe fever aa gaya, but it's when you measure it is not a fever. Now why is that happening in pregnancy anyways? Anybody can answer that? Why does the woman feel this feverish and sensation of warmth, and this palms become all warm and red, and there's this heat coming out of the head that the woman says that she feels like that? So why does she feel like that? Anybody? It's a normal physiological phenomenon in pregnancy. Anybody? Why does it happen? Why does that happen? Again, it's a progesterone-related effect. I told you progesterone causes smooth muscle relaxation. So progesterone causes vasodilatation. Now this vasodilatation, mind you, is not just limited to the systemic circulation. This vasodilatation is going to be happening in the systemic vessels, systemic vascular circulation as well. That is going to lead to decrease in BP. It also happens in the cutaneous circulation. So more blood, you know, coming to increase blood flow into the cutaneous vessels, that gives the sensation of warmth. And also there is, you know, vasodilatation, the pulmonary circulation as well. So all of these circulations, they are vasodilated, and there is increased flow to the lungs, there is increased flow to the limbs and palms and everywhere. So progesterone related effect causes this sensation of feverishness and warmth. Okay, now decreased fetal movements. Let's just focus on decreased fetal movements. How many fetal movements are decreased fetal movement? Mariam is also saying increased metabolic rate. I did not see that. Yes, progesterone is a thermogenic hormone. And it is also, there is an increased basal metabolic rate in pregnancy, which leads to that sensation. Very good. So we've answered all aspects of that, all aspects of those physiological changes. Now, my next question to you guys is, what is this decreased fetal movements, right? And when do we start telling the woman to count her fetal movements? My first question is that. Rashmi, contraction ni movement. I'm talking about movement, fetal movements that a woman perceives. Dekho bhai, simple si baat hai. The fetus is with the mother, inside the mother. When the mother goes home, the fetus is with the mother. So the first and foremost knowledge of something is wrong with the fetus would be known by the mother only, because the fetus will tell the mother, I'm not okay. How? Because fetus will start moving less, decrease fetal movements. Aapko bukhar aa jata hai, you feel ill, we feel ill and we feel not okay, we just lie down bed na, but our movements get restricted, isn't it? Similarly, when the fetus is not doing okay, the fetus also stops moving. So when do we call it as decreased fetal movements? Yes, I've still not got the answer. Only Rashmi said, when do we call it as decreased fetal movements? So my question is to you, how do we then counsel the woman about fetal movements? What is decreased fetal movements? Well, every woman, once she starts perceiving movement, she gets an idea about what normal fetal movements are like. From 32 weeks onwards, we start the woman to take a note of fetal movements. नाउ यू कैन ऑल्सो अग्री विद मी हियर कि ऐसा तो नहीं है दैट द वुमन डज नॉट हैव एनी वर्क ड्यूरिंग द डे. शी विल लीव एवरीथिंग असाइड एंड कीप काउंटिंग द फीटल मूवमेंट्स थ्रू आउट द डे. सो शी कैन नॉट डू दैट. सो वट वी आस्क हर इज टू चूज अ टाइम ड्यूरिंग द डे वेन शी इज रिलेटिवली रिलैक्सड. इट कैन बी आफ्टर अ मील इन हर इवनिंग टाइम. वेन एवर वेन एवर शी इज कंफर्टेबली रिलैक्स शी नीड्स टू लाई डाउन ऑन बेड इन द लेफ्ट लेटरल पोजिशन एंड मेक अ नोट और काउंट द फीटल मूवमेंट्स. एंड once she counts 10 movements, 10 fetal movement, when she counts, she stops counting. And ideally, she should be able to perceive 10 movements within 2 hours. If there are less than 10 movements in 2 hours, that's abnormal, right? So that is called as Cardiff count to 10 formula, right? So please remember this also. How do we counsel the woman to, you know, make a note of fetal movements, okay? Now let's move forward and talk about the other now let's talk about the various clinical minor ailments that a woman complains of. So let's talk about nausea and vomiting and heartburn in pregnancy. Why is there nausea and vomiting in pregnancy? Why is there nausea and vomiting in pregnancy? It's because of the increase in beta HCG. It's because of this increase in beta HCG. Now most women will have some or the other degree of nausea and vomiting in pregnancy. Some are bothered more, some are bothered less. And it peaks, this nausea and vomiting peaks somewhere around 8 to 9 weeks. Around 8 to 9 weeks it peaks. And for most women, it will subside completely within 16 weeks. So within 16 weeks, it is going to subside completely for most women. So mostly women are bothered by this complaint in the first trimester, right? Why does heartburn happen in pregnancy? This acidity and this heartburn. Why does this heartburn happen in pregnancy? Again, because of progesterone. Progesterone, causes, again, the dilatation of the lower esophageal sphincter, causes relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter, okay? And that causes reflux. So this reflux is responsible for causing the heartburn in pregnancy. And you can also understand that as pregnancy advances, as she moves into the second trimester, then the third trimester, and the uterus is going to grow bigger in size, then the top of the uterus is going to push up against the diaphragm. When that will happen, some compression of the stomach will also be there, isn't it? And that is going to aggravate her heartburn. So heartburn, a woman is troubled by heartburn in early pregnancy also because of the progesterone related relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter. And this can get particularly aggravated as pregnancy advances because the enlarging uterus will push against the diaphragm and it is going to cause compression of the stomach as well. So how do we counsel the woman regarding these changes? I will say that these are usual physiological changes. They happen to most of the women in pregnancy. So I'm going to go for a normal physiological advice. I'm going to tell her to go for dietary changes. Now, what are the dietary changes that I'm talking about? The dietary changes that I'm talking about are basically just have a diet modulation, like for example, take small frequent meals. Instead of eating, too much at one go, take small frequent meals. So instead of eating three daily large meals, she's going to, move to start taking, let's say, a smaller breakfast and then a snack after breakfast, then lunch and then a midday snack, after that dinner. So take small frequent meals, okay? Avoid trigger foods. Sometimes women do identify certain trigger foods which give her more nausea and vomiting, so she's supposed to avoid that. Another homemade, homemade recipe or homemade remedy that we call it, that she's supposed to eat whenever she has that nausea. See, when it's called morning sickness, mind you, it's called morning sickness. But I want to emphasize on that is it's not necessarily nausea happening always in the morning. A woman who is pregnant can have nausea or vomiting anytime during the day. मॉर्निंग सिकनेस बोलते हैं इसको, बट हमेशा मॉर्निंग में नहीं होता, इट्स नॉट ऑलवेज हैपनिंग इन द मॉर्निंग, बट नॉनदलेस अ वुमन इज एडवाइज्ड टू यू नो टेक मोर ऑफ सॉलिड्स एंड अवॉइड ड्रिंकिंग टू मच वाटर अलॉन्ग विद द फूड. सो दीज आर सर्टन जनरल सटल चेंजेस दैट कैन बी एडवाइज्ड. और शी कैन बी एडवाइज्ड टू टेक यू नो अ टोस्ट, अ करारा टोस्ट, अ क्रिस्प टोस्ट और अ प्लेन रोटी, सॉलिड रोटी विदाउट एनी सॉल्ट और एनी thing. The first thing that she eats in the morning should be a solid food rather than, you know, a liquidy material. And, you know, she can avoid tea, coffee, and all of these things need to be avoided because, again, these are the things which will lead to more heartburn. So, thus, such dietary changes, avoiding trigger foods. And then again, in the later part of pregnancy, if the heartburn is too much, then she's advised to, you know, take rest in a reclining position rather than lying down on the back, because if she's going to lie down on the back, straight lying down on the back while sleeping, there's going to be more reflux, there's going to be more compression of the uterus or the diaphragm. So she's advised to sit in a reclining position or rest in a semi-reclining position during the as the pregnancy advances. So this is how nausea and vomiting and heartburn will be managed. But yes, if you tell me ke bhai bahut hi severe ho gaya, woman is dietary changes kar liye, trigger foods avoid kar liye, nothing is happening, so yes, antacids can be prescribed for heartburn. And yes, we can go for those solutions. Those are the aluminium hydroxide solutions. Those the locally acting antacids can be used in pregnancy. Maybe if a woman does not even get relieved by that, then one or two dosages of ranitidine, that is the antihistaminic, ranitidine drug can also, H1 blocker drugs, they could be given. So antacids can be given for heartburn, but first, yes, of course, the dietary changes and the usual modification should be started first before going on to the medication. Now, what about this nausea and vomiting? What can we give for the nausea and vomiting? Anybody? Yes? Anybody answering this? What medications can be given for nausea and vomiting in pregnancy? We've tried everything, it's not working. We've tried the usual changes and it's not working. What are the medications that we can give for nausea and vomiting? The medication that is usually resorted to initially is vitamin B6 and doxylamine tablets. Doxylamine is also an antihistaminic drug. It is an antihistaminic drug which has anti-emetic properties also. So vitamin B6 and doxylamine tablets can be given. And then yes, Dr. Musarat, ondansetron, I can use ondansetron also, metoclopramide also, promethazine also. So these are the drugs that can be used. But yes, we have to try vitamin B6 and doxylamine tablets first. Initially, they can be taken, let's say, every night. Okay, they can be taken at bedtime. We can also ask the woman to take them twice daily or thrice daily, but not more than that. Okay, not more than three times a day. So that is what is required. And yes, I would be thinking of avoiding metoclopramide and ondansetron early on in pregnancy. So I would definitely try vitamin B6 plus doxylamine tablets first, and the rest of the medication need to be started if the nausea and vomiting is not getting controlled with the initial first line treatment. And sometimes a woman can have hyperemesis. What is hyperemesis? What is hyperemesis? As the name suggests, hyperemesis means excessive vomiting. Emesis for vomiting, hyper for excessive. So if there is hyperemesis, how much vomiting is hyperemesis? Is there a threshold on the number of vomitings in a day? Usually there cannot be. Usually there is not a threshold on the number of vomitings. Rashmi is very rightly saying any hyperemesis that makes the woman unable to do her daily work. If she is so decompensated with the vomiting, ki wo apna roz ka kaam bhi nahi kar pa rahi hai. If her daily lifestyle is getting affected, if her daily work and routine is getting affected, that's hyperemesis, my friends. Three episodes, there's no criteria on the episodes. So Rashmi is right, Dr. Musarrat is also right. Any emesis in which she is unable to eat only, any vomiting where she is unable to eat. If woman says that every time I eat, I vomit it out and I have not been able to eat the whole day, that's hyperemesis. If there is so much vomiting that she has gotten dehydrated, that is hyperemesis, right? If she is having weight reduction instead of gaining weight in pregnancy, she's losing weight, rapidly losing weight because she's unable to eat anything. So these are your signs suggestive of hyperemesis. And if that's the situation, then the woman needs to get admitted, because when she'll get dehydrated, when she'll be unable to eat, she will end up in ketosis. The other complication that can happen because of this is ketosis, isn't it? So now is the time to admit her, give her IV fluids, right, to take care of this ketosis. And then these medications like metoclopramide, ondansetron, these same medication can be given by the intravenous route or the IV route. So that's management of hyperemesis for you. Okay, so can you understand now that if the nausea, vomiting and heartburn are only mild in pregnancy, one can start with the dietary changes, avoiding trigger foods, then you can start with the most mild medication, vitamin B6 and doxylamine. One can give oral metoclopramide, ondansetron, promethazine also. But if she's having hyperemesis, where she's unable to eat, she's dehydrated, she's losing weight, the complication is ketosis, so there the woman needs to be admitted. She needs to be given IV fluids, and these same medications will be started in IV medication form. Okay, IV drugs that are going to be given. And also, because she's unable to eat at all, she's going to suffer from severe thiamine deficiency. So B complex vitamins are also given, right? So yes, right? So we're clear on that. Yeah, so that is how your hyperemesis is going to be managed. But today we are talking about the routine antenatal care, so I'll move forward and talk about backache and leg cramps. Now a lot of women in pregnancy, they do complain of backache and leg cramps also. And why does that happen? Why these women complain of backache? So you see, a woman is gaining weight in pregnancy. Throughout pregnancy, she's gaining weight. So a lot of the times, women are going to complain of backache and leg cramps from the second trimester onwards, not in the first trimester. Moreover, there is an excessive lordosis. You see that the belly is bulking up and the back is arched like this. So there's a lot of excessive lordosis, right, in pregnancy. So that also predisposes to a backache in pregnancy. And faulty posture. It's very important for the to emphasize on the mother the need to maintain a right posture during sitting. So she should sit with her back straight and not curved or hunched like this or not like this, because that is going to increase the backache problem. So faulty posture is also accountable for the backache that she suffers in pregnancy. And moreover, if a woman has not been having adequate calcium stores pre-pregnancy, pehle se hi she is a lean and thin woman, and she's, you know, she does not have a good nutritional status, build bhi uski kam hai. So there could be a calcium deficiency, which is also contributing to the backache. So that will be taken care of by giving calcium supplementation in pregnancy. Now calcium supplementation in pregnancy is required in a dose of about, how much is the calcium requirement? 1000 milligram per day, right? So we can give those 500 milligram tablets, they are coming. We can give them once daily or twice daily. We can give them once daily or twice daily. We can give this calcium supplementation. Vitamin D supplementation can also be given in pregnancy. But yes, people do tend to give it as a routine. But yes, it is better to document on blood reports that there is vitamin deficiency, and then one can give vitamin D supplementation. Please note that vitamin D supplementation should never be given in the first trimester. Never in the first trimester, because of teratogenic effect. So please keep that in mind. Do not give vitamin D supplementation in the first trimester. If at all required, it is given in the second trimester onwards, right? And the next important aspect to note here is very, very important. Please keep in mind, while prescribing iron and folic acid and calcium supplementation both to the woman, it is very, very important. We are giving iron, folic acid also, isn't it? And we are giving calcium also, right? So it is very, very important to advise to the woman that she should not take these two tablets together, because then calcium is going to interfere with the absorption of iron. So you don't want that, right? So it is better that she takes this iron folic acid tablet during daytime. She takes it during daytime and she takes this, let's say, at bedtime. So they should be taken not together but far apart. At least 2 hours gap should be there. At least 2 hours gap should be there in between taking iron folic acid tablets and calcium tablets. The usual dictum that we use is that iron se kyunki bahut sara GI upset and, you know, gastrointestinal side effects hote hai. So it's better to take iron during the daytime and then calcium can be taken at the bedtime if she is taking both of these supplements. Okay, Dr. Musarat, can we give calcium in the first trimester? Well, we should not. We should not avoid giving calcium in the first trimester as well. Again, because of these GI problems and side effects. She'll not be able to tolerate calcium also. However, calcium ke saath koi aisa teratogenic effect nahi hai that it is absolutely contraindicated, but usually not required and not given in the first trimester, Dr. Musarat. Okay. Now, the next important thing is, women can also complain of leg cramps, and one of the reasons why women complain of leg cramps is again similarly because of calcium deficiency also, and women can have leg cramps also because of varicose veins. You see, there are certain women in pregnancy that develop varicosities in the lower limbs, right? And there are many reasons for that. One of the reasons is obviously a predilection for having varicose veins. Or maybe her lifestyle is such that, you know, she's a teacher. She has to walk around a lot and she has to stand in front of the blackboard and write. So all that will also predispose. Moreover, the gravid uterus, the uterus is going to compress on the pelvic veins. And that is going to increase the chances of having varicose veins in pregnancy. So if a woman is having varicosity, she's going to complain of leg cramps. And then for varicose veins, we don't need to go for any extensive treatment. Simple leg elevation and elastic stockings, you know. So she would be asked, okay, make it a point that, you know, 3 times in a day you're sitting comfortably and you elevate your leg and take care about that. You know, sit with the stool in front of you. Do not keep standing always, or do not sit with your legs hanging down. So leg elevation is going to be helpful. Elastic stockings are going to be helpful. So these are going to be tried first for varicose veins before we move on to some surgical management. And usually these procedures are going to suffice most of the times, right? Now, moving on further, a woman, I told you, often complains of constipation and hemorrhoids. So I told you that having a dietary modification, a fiber-rich diet, taking plenty of water should help, right? Apart from that, if that is also not helping, stool softeners can be used in pregnancy. So stool softeners in the form of laxatives, right? So these laxatives, which are available in the market, they can be used in pregnancy. But yes, I would give preference to those husk laxatives, right, instead of using the lignocaine containing laxatives. So I have to be careful about what kind of laxatives I'm giving. So I would give preference to the bulk laxatives or the Isabgol husks, which are often used as a first liner, because of course they don't contain any drugs or anything. So those stool softeners can be used in pregnancies. And the other important thing is hemorrhoids. Sometimes in pregnancy, women can also complain of hemorrhoids because again she's constipated, she's straining at stools, which is leading to hemorrhoids. And add to that the compression of the gravid uterus on the pelvic veins, that also predisposes to hemorrhoids. So again, conservative management is going to work. So we try stool softeners again to avoid these hemorrhoids from bleeding, right? And we can also give a local lignocaine jelly which she can use every time before defecating, so that pain during passage of stools is avoided. Because if she's having constipation and she's straining at stool, the other thing that can happen is a fissure formation. So we can give those local lignocaine jellies to apply to avoid all those side effects. Right. So conservative management of these complaints, these ailments is recommended. Right. Moving on further, women sometimes can also complain of pain in the lower abdomen in pregnancy. Now, yes, pain in the lower abdomen is definitely a harbinger towards, you would say, ectopic, you would say abortion. Yes, I mean, all those medical complications, obstetric complications can definitely be there. But there can be some common causes of pain in the lower abdomen also, like there could be a cystitis. There could be an infection of urine. There can be UTI, urinary tract infection, cystitis, that could cause pain in the lower abdomen. And that's why, maintaining hydration in pregnancy is so important, because pregnancy is a state of, where UTI or urinary tract infection chances increases. Why is that? Because you see, progesterone causes vasodilatation. Progesterone causes smooth muscle relaxation. So progesterone also causes the dilatation of the renal system. So this is the kidneys, this is the ureter, and that's your bladder, right? Now progesterone causes dilatation of this ureter, so hydroureter. Okay, so progesterone causes this dilatation of the ureter, okay, that causes urinary stasis. Moreover, there is an increased frequency of micturition during pregnancy as well. So a woman will have that sensation, that she is going to the toilet every other time, she's frequently going to the toilet, but she's not evacuating completely, right? She'll get that feeling of urinary stasis, and that urinary stasis predisposes to urinary tract infection in pregnancy. Now, one way to deal with it is to maintain adequate hydration, to passing urine most of the times, and that is just the preventive method that has to be followed, even if that means going to the urine, bathroom a lot, right? And yes, pelvic girdle pain. That is the point that I'm coming to. Round ligament pain. Most often there is a complaint of round ligament pain also. So this uterus, as it is enlarging in pregnancy, these are the round ligaments, and these round ligaments, they travel in the inguinal canal to come and attach where? To the labia majora. So these round ligaments, they get stretched. That's why women complain of round ligament pain or pain in the lower abdomen, especially after the second trimester, when the uterus has become large. The round ligaments, they stretch. So the woman complains of this pain, and you ask in history that she has lower abdominal pain, you ask her, when does it happen? It usually happens maybe sometimes on both the sides or sometimes on one side, but it usually happens whenever she changes her posture suddenly, or she suddenly gets up from the bed, or she suddenly turns in one direction. So she's sleeping and then she suddenly takes a turn, and then one side of the round ligament gets stretched, and that leads to this round ligament pain, sharp stabbing pain, which is mostly confined to the lower abdomen and radiating towards the groins as well. And it's due to sudden movements and change in posture. It's because of the stretching of the round ligaments. It's also more commonly seen on the right side, right? It is more commonly seen on the right side also, because the uterus is also slightly more dextrorotated, stretching the right side more as compared to the left side. Now, how do we manage this? It can be managed, first of all, by advising the woman to avoid sudden changes in posture. Okay, so she's asked to get up slowly from the bed. Any jerking movement she should avoid. For example, these are usual subtle changes that she needs to introduce in her lifestyle. Okay, so avoid sudden movements, avoid getting up too quickly from the bed. Or sometimes, let's say, for example, you're walking and something fell down and you have to pick it up from the floor. You bend all the way down and pick it up. So that's something that would cause compression here on the lower abdomen. That something should be avoided. So you ask the woman that if she has to pick something up from the floor, she should better squat and then pick it up from the floor. So some usual, routine changes need to be introduced, and she needs to be counseled about this. She needs to be assured that there's nothing to fear from this lower abdomen or round ligament pain. It's something physiological. And yes, if that also doesn't work, one can try that heat application. Local heat application helps in relaxing the smooth muscles of the round ligament, and smooth muscle relaxants are the last resort. Medication are the last resort, but yes, one can try the conservative management. Local heat application will also help in this situation. Okay. Acupuncture, Dr. Musarat, I am not aware of acupuncture, and so I'll have to read up more on that. I'm personally not aware of the role of acupuncture in that. Okay. Now, the next complaint that women often tend to make in pregnancy is that of dizziness and syncope. Chakkar nahi aa jaate. I mean, you must have seen in the movies that how is pregnancy diagnosed? When a woman faints. That's actually not true, but yes, a woman does tend to complain of dizziness and having some momentarily blackouts. And why does this happen in pregnancy? Why do you think that this would happen in pregnancy? These sudden episodes of dizziness and blackouts, and they are common, especially, let me give you a hint, they are more so in the second trimester onwards, and not in the first trimester. Why this dizziness and sudden syncope, they happen in pregnancy? Why do you think that happens? Yes, anybody? It's again progesterone. You see, progesterone causes systemic peripheral vasodilatation. It causes a decrease in BP. There's a decrease in BP that happens. All right. And of course, there is this increase in the blood flow towards the placenta also. Right. So you can understand that a woman who is walking around, right, and because of pregnancy related changes, she's having low BP. On top of that, if she's not drinking enough water, she is aggravating the problem. On top of that, it is the placenta, the fetus, growing fetus, that is taking a lot of blood volume from the mother. All right, placenta is extracting all that blood from the mother, using it for itself. So that leaves a sudden state of sudden low BP in pregnancies, in pregnant women, especially from the second trimester onwards. So she can have these episodes of dizziness and syncope. Simple thing, you counsel the woman, whenever she has that episode, just lie down. And she need not worry about this. Many times women feel very scared with these symptoms. So you need to tell her that these are normal physiological changes. They are going to settle down. All you need to do is whenever you feel slight dizzy and syncope, just rest. Lie down. It is going to improve. And lying down in the left lateral position. She's asked to lie down in the left lateral position. That's the best position to be in, isn't it? And why is the best position to be in is the left lateral position? There are many advantages of this left lateral position because it avoids what? Supine hypertension syndrome. As pregnancy advances, what happens is that this is the big uterus. This is a big uterus. Okay, there's a big baby inside. All right, this gravid uterus can cause compression. This is gravid uterus. The uterus is slightly dextro rotated. It is dextro rotated. It is slightly rotated to the right side, so it falls more on the inferior vena cava. I'll draw this with blue. Okay, it falls more on the inferior vena cava, so it causes compression of the inferior vena cava. When the inferior vena cava is going to get compressed, it is going to lead to decreased venous return. And that is going to further lead to a decrease in cardiac output. Right? So that's why lying down supine can cause supine hypertension syndrome. It is going to get further aggravated if the woman has been lying down and sleeping for a long time and then she suddenly gets up off the bed. Okay, like you and I can do it, we're lying down and we suddenly get up from bed standing. But a pregnant woman should avoid that. She should be asked to first slowly sit in bed, stay in that position for a couple of minutes, and then take her time to get up. So if she's lying down, she should lie down preferably in the left lateral position, right? Because in that position, the uterus is lifted up and the compression on inferior vena cava is also lifted up. So that's the best position to be in. left lateral position. All right. Also, the left lateral position, first of all, I told you that it is going to avoid this supine hypotension. And moreover, it is also going to promote placental flow. It is also going to promote placental blood flow, uteroplacental blood flow. Promote uteroplacental blood flow. So both mother and baby are going to benefit when a woman is lying down in the left lateral position. All right. And it is for this reason that I particularly tell my pregnant patients to do not drive, especially from the second trimester onwards, because many women tend to ask this question, is driving okay for my baby? I say driving is perfectly okay for the baby, but driving is not okay for you. Because in second trimester, the woman can have, she's been sitting there behind the driving wheel, and then she's driving, and that can lead to all that peripheral pooling of blood. And she can have that sudden blackout, and then it's a recipe for disaster. She can have an accident. So I particularly tell my pregnant patients to avoid, especially long driving, in the second trimester onwards. She should not be doing that. Okay. Now, moving on further, some women also complain of having vascular spiders, okay? And these are especially problematic and especially more noticeable in fair-skinned women, all right? These vascular spiders are like this. They are mostly occurring on the breast or chest or the upper arm, so in the upper area of the body. This is because of estrogen. These are because of estrogen that is coming from the placenta, estrogen-related changes, and there is a central dilated arteriole here on which there can be seen branching radicles of arterioles. Again, dilated arterioles and dilated centrally, there's a dilated area, okay, and on that you can see radiating arterioles also. So it is a vascular spider, looks like a spider, and these are again a normal phenomena that will be over once the pregnancy is over. So she's going to get these are not permanent lesions, okay? So these are nothing to fear from these lesions. They are not permanent. They will not lead to scarring also, and they are going to just simply disappear when the pregnancy is over. So a woman just needs to be counseled that these are usual physiological changes and they will resolve once the pregnancy is over. And vaginal discharge, finally, women sometimes in pregnancy complain of vaginal discharge. Whenever a woman does so, please do not just disregard it saying that vaginal discharge sabko hota hai. Do not do that. A pregnant woman complains of vaginal discharge, make sure that you examine her. She should be evaluated. A per speculum examination should be done. She should be asked about other associated symptoms of itching, of burning, of having dysuria or associated urinary complaints. So evaluate the vaginal discharge like you would evaluate a non-pregnant woman also. So she should be evaluated. And if infection is present, if you find a candidal discharge, if you find a bacterial vaginosis, or you find evidence of trichomoniasis or anything, that infection should be treated. So treatment should be done if infection is identified. And generally, please remember that, for example, if you have to treat bacterial vaginosis or candidiasis or any of these vaginitis in pregnancy, local treatment is preferred. So local treatment is preferred. That means what? It means you can give clotrimazole vaginal pessaries. We can give clotrimazole vaginal pessaries, and this would be given for the fungal infections like candidiasis. We can give these metronidazole pessaries are there, Miconazole pessaries are with clotrimazole, metronidazole pessaries and gels can be used in the vagina for bacterial vaginosis and trichomoniasis, right? So these are the common infections. And yes, you can treat them. In fact, you should treat them if a woman is symptomatic with these infections, but give preference to local treatment. It's not like oral fluconazole you should not give. So clotrimazole vaginal pessaries for fungal infections, and for bacterial vaginosis and trichomoniasis, metronidazole pessaries and gels, local treatment should be given. Okay? Clear? And I think I have, that's my time, guys. Any doubt about this? A lot of the common problems and complaints and ailments of women in pregnancy have been considered. If you have any other problem in mind, please ask me. If you think I have missed on any other common ailment or I'm emphasizing on common. If you think of any other common ailment that you need to ask me about, you can ask me right now. So sometimes women also tend to, one of the common complaints that I remember my pregnant patients asking me about is they often tend to complain of headache. And headache obviously is a dangerous sign, particularly in the presence of hypertension in pregnancy. I don't deny that. So whenever a woman complains to me of headache, I definitely want to check her BP to figure out if there is a hypertension along with that. If not, then there is also a tendency for headache in pregnancy. Why? Because of, again, the progesterone causes vasodilatation. So there's vasodilatation in the vessels of the nasal mucosa also. So that causes nasal stuffiness and nasal blockage. And that can also lead to headache in pregnancy sometimes. So those are also common complaints. Generalized itching. Yes, Dr. Musarat, the generalized itching is bad, but some itching of women do tend to complain, especially over the breasts and the abdomen. That's okay. Over the chest and the abdomen is okay. And that's because mainly because of the stretching of skin that it takes place. So that kind of itching is normal in pregnancy. That can be resolved by, usually just maybe applying some lotion on the skin, maybe a lactocalamine lotion. Just that much is required. But one thing that I want to point out there also, if a woman complains to you of itching over the palms and the soles, over the limbs and the legs, or over the scalp, or generalized all over the body, that kind of an itching should be investigated into. It could be obstetric cholestasis, right? So as long as the itching is limited to the breasts and the abdomen, it's okay. But the moment she starts complaining of itching over the palms and the soles, and itching over the limbs and lower limbs and upper limbs, and generalized itching all over the body, then she needs to be investigated further. Maybe it could be an obstetric cholestasis. Okay. Again, burning feet and soles. Again, that's because of that progesterone related changes. So burning feet and soles is a normal physiological phenomena of pregnancy. Just ensure that she is actually not having fever. But yes, for that, you will have to use a thermometer and check her temperature. Ask her to do that herself. But for generalized, this sense of warmth coming out of the palms and the soles, one need to try conservative measures, isn't it? Just maybe a cold compress sometimes. I've seen my patients applying Mehndi also and Alka also. So they do that. They do try the local remedies. But once you tell the woman that it is something that is not harmful for the baby, it's something that's a physiological change in pregnancy, they do come around it. They do come around it. Okay? And numbness in the hands. Now, numbness in the hands, Dr. Musarat, is not something that is very common, though, I would tell you. But yes, the women tend to, especially if there is vitamin deficiencies. So yes, sometimes vitamin supplements can help because of that, for the numbness in hands. But it's something that is not commonly seen. Okay. So that's been my guys, that's been my time guys. Thank you so much. And for the free live classes that I have scheduled. So yesterday we talked about the ROP position, and today we are going to talk about breech vaginal delivery. That's again at 8 p.m. That's a special class on the Plus platform of Unacademy. So you can subscribe to the platform and you can use my code, that is SHONALI, to get a 10% discount on your subscription. Thank you so much. Okay. Yes, Dr. Musarat, I will be working on infections, but I do not promise you that it is going to be the immediate next section, but I will have it soon. Okay. Thank you so much. Goodbye. Take care. Have a nice day.